嗨，大家好，今天来到我们演播室的嘉宾是全球首部公开版权的纪录片《The Mind of the Universe》的导演 Mr.Allen Swantee 先生。这部纪录片刚刚完成在北京、上海的拍摄片段，让我们赶快了解一下情况吧。Hi, thank you so much for coming. Could I first please ask you to introduce yourself a bit more to the audience here?
Yes, of course.My name is Gijs Meijer Swantee, your presenter just explained. I'm working for VPRO Dutch Television, and we are specialized in travel series and scientific programs. And the programs we make are general for not only for the Dutch audience, but for European and non-European audiences. So our programs are normally aired on TV in about 15 to 20 countries.
Wow. And also know this.TV project is the first, the world's first open source TV project, right?
Yeah, it's funny to see that it's so, that TV is so conservative that it is actually for the first time that a TV channel opens up all its raw footage for a general public to freely use it in any way the public wants to use it.
Wow.
And that it's so difficult for other broadcasters to understand that.
Yeah, it shows that you're very generous in this aspect.
Yeah, it was the idea. The idea is also because of The Mind of the Universe is a scientific series in which we want to explore the frontiers of knowledge.
I see. How did this all start?
It started when my colleagues and I were at the Institute of Advanced Study in Princeton, which is a very renowned institute.
Yeah.
Einstein was the first director,
of course, yeah.
Oppenheimer the second. Yeah. So
the smartest person.
Yeah,
in the
it
world.
Was like the temple of scientific gods where we walked around.
Yes.
And we thought, what is happening at this moment? We see an acceleration of knowledge. People living in remote areas in Africa, in Mongolia, and wherever have access to all the knowledge that is available in universities, in knowledge institutes, in locations where before people had not access to that knowledge. And because of the fact that they have now access to it and can also give their own, share their own knowledge,
yes,
you see
yes.
this, that there is a kind of, it starts to exist a kind of cognosphere around the Earth. So it's not only a biosphere, but also a kind of, as if we are creating one big brain with each other.
Yeah, like an infosphere.
Like a huge infosphere,
yeah.
Yeah, it's like an infosphere, and well, we call it the mind of the universe, in which we say that this infosphere, this mind, is getting conscious of where we are going to as human species, but also as universe.
Wow.
So that was the start of the idea, and then we elaborated on that, and we thought, well, if you do that, you want to portray the best scientists in the world. And understand what they are doing and what it means what they are doing.
How many scientists will be portrayed in the TV series?
We will have 30 scientists worldwide, so from every continent. They will be portrayed in 10 episodes. That's the TV.
10 episodes?
Yeah, that's the TV story. So the TV has 10 episodes of 15 minutes. Three scientists per episode. And then the raw footage, which is of course much more, is accessible for everyone to use. So a part of the series. The series is more or less a way of triggering people to want to do more with the material. To see, oh wow, that's interesting. I want to understand better what this man or woman is doing in that specific field of interest.
You know, I watched the trailer of the Mind of Universe. Mm-hmm. I have to say, I'm totally blown away, yeah, and
nice.
I'm quite interested in it. And
also,
and there are many what if questions in the trailer,
yeah.
Like what if we can stop aging? What if we can program organisms and societies?
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, you mentioned 10 episodes, right? But the content of each episode mainly focus on the answers to each what if question?
No, the answers are part of it, but it's not like that we are, it's more that we ask the questions. And then the scientists, we have, for example, in the United States, we have a scientist who is specialized in reverse aging in a way, CRISPR. That's like that you can edit DNA in every way you want. So you can really
Stop aging.
Stop aging.
Wow.
Or change. Yeah, everything you want. You can.
How soon will that happen?
That's happening now.
It's happening now.
It's, wow. This moment, it's happening, and it's
huge.
That is huge. It's really a revolution, and the consequences of that is hardly understandable because it's also dangerous in a way. You can think of the fact that everyone with blue eyes or with brown eyes or with green eyes should be this way or that way pushed, and that's the other side. That's
like a dilemma, right?
Yeah, but that's more the dystopia. We are looking more at the utopia. So we want to understand, okay, so you can do that. What does it mean? All kind of diseases are
kind of eliminated.
Can be eliminated. All kind of birth-related diseases eliminated.
Like bird flu.
Yeah, those kind of things you can change. And that's CRISPR. It's the newest technology.
So it's like knowledge is already there. Solutions are already there. Yeah. We just need a platform, need this kind of TV series to help us know it, to access to it, have access to it.
To understand what it means and how it works. And I was myself completely surprised that we were so far, as human species, in editing of DNA and everything, and all the consequences that come out of that.
Yes, wow, quite interesting.
And here in China, for example, we portrayed Professor Jean-Louis Pan. He's
the quantum expert, right?
Yeah, he's the one, he's in quantum mechanics and quantum physics and in quantum communication.
Yeah.
And he's really, China is in front of everybody. The forerunner. They really, you are really the...
Yeah, I know that. And I think the audience also know that on August 16th, China launched the first quantum satellite. And the person who was leading this project was Jian Wei Pan.
That's correct. Yeah.
Wow.
And what we did, and it may be, of course, other channels will do that also, but we take the time. So we have not an hour with him or a day. Now we have 3 days with him. We film at his house. We film at the laboratories, at the observatory in Beijing, in Shanghai, in Hefei. So we really take the time to portray the man in a way that hasn't been done before, according to him.
Wow. Good. Wow. Yeah. We would love to really kind of get access to the knowledge behind this mastermind of the satellite, the first satellite, quantum satellite.
Yeah, no, it's amazing how far ahead he is, and his team, of course, he's not alone, but... It's very impressive for me.
Good, so I can see that you really got the world's prominent scientists portrayed in your TV series.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
And. Is there any like criteria how you choose whom to portray?
Now,
portrayed?
What we did is we have a research team, and we of course it's always a bit arbitrary who you choose because there are more top scientists, but we do it in good collaboration with our host, which is the current director of the Institute of Advanced Study in Princeton.
Wow.
So he is the one that says, okay, that person, okay, good, that person, no. Mm-hmm. We also want to make it diverse, so we want all continents represented.
Mm-hmm.
And what you see is, in all continents, top scientists are working in a certain field. It can be in a locally important field, like in Africa, in Kenya, we filmed an insectologist. How do you say it? Specialized in insects and in the
like mosquitoes.
Yeah, things like that, and very important work. Mm-hmm. And she, so that's an example that's for Africa very good. But what she does is also very important for China and for Europe and for the United States and South America.
Good. You want to make it beneficial, not in a in the region, in a global wide, worldwide.
Yeah, and she was actually awarded with the kind of Hero of China Award. She was the
Of China Award.
Yes, yeah, something I don't know exactly the name. My colleague did it, but she stood there at the stage here in Beijing, and then she said, "It's so strange that China honors me, while I should do this for Africa. I mean, what my work is so important for China. It's so important for South America. She worked then in Colombia." Why don't I go back to Africa to help my own people? And then she got back to Africa and now serves her countries.
I see. So she goes to the place where she's needed the most.
Yeah.
Wow. Yeah. Very impressive.
And then another person we portrayed is, for example, a scientist, a neuroscientist in Brazil. mm-hmm. who is now working on helping people who are disabled, so they have they can't walk, to get feeling back and even able to start walking again.
Wow, so to get recovered.
Recover. Oh. To with an exoskeleton, try to help people by thinking, getting to move again. So that's also an example. And
Well, those are really the high-end technology or the frontier of technology and science. But maybe my next question is, from the ordinary people's perspective, mm-hmm. whether they find it, like the content, too mm-hmm. far or too difficult for ordinary people to reach and find connection with?
No, because I myself, for example, I'm not a quantum physics mm-hmm. person, so I ask quite stupid questions. I'm Professor Jean Dupin, because I want to understand what he's doing. Uh-huh. So he explains it in different ways, a technical way, which is for the hardcore quantum mm-hmm. physicists interesting, mm-hmm. But also in a more accessible way that I, and with me also the viewers, mm-hmm. can understand it. So we want to make sure that it is usable by a big audience, so that people can do their thing with it. I'm mm-hmm. not saying that it always works that way, because it's some people are a little bit difficult and very technical. And then I think, well, the whole interview is interesting for people that are a bit informed about that mm-hmm. certain topic.
At least we can better understand.
Yeah.
First, understand what the technology science, how advanced it is out there, and what benefits we can get for us. And then we can also give our kind of suggestions to help improve, or see how we can really get involved in this in this project and get better prepared for tomorrow. And you're gonna be knowing what's gonna happen in the future, right?
Yeah, and that's also the idea of this series, because we started to work together with the open universities, and we looked for learning partners, so that the material that we are shooting is not only used for TV or for just as raw footage, but that the raw footage is also repackaged in learning experiences.
I see. That brings me to I just thought of the Dr. Frag from UNESCO, mm-hmm. and he told me, and also actually he introduced this project to me, and he said this project is actually composed of three components. Mm-hmm. The TV series is just the first one, right? And that's what you're doing. And the second one is called digital platform, and the third one is learning experience.
Yes, correct. Right?
Can we elaborate a bit more on the last two parts?
Yes, the TV series is clear. The digital platform is more that we have found a smart way to have people worldwide getting access to all the raw footage. So we are partnering with partners worldwide mm-hmm. to make sure that we reach the biggest audience as possible mm-hmm. to do whatever they want with the material. So they can access the material, they can make their own,
because it's open source, right?
Completely open source, free to use for everyone.
Wow. So we can reuse, even remake and even maybe replace the
put more Chinese scientists in it.
Chinese scientists or different anchorman there.
Yeah.
And even add a new episode, like an 11th episode to TV
series. Yeah, 12, 13, 14, 15, as many as you want. And also
very good.
Put that in the platform itself, so the platform is growing.
I see. The platform is called The Mind of the Universe?
Yeah.
I see. So it's kind of like how Wikipedia got...
A bit, We work also together with Wikipedia, actually.
Inspired by Wikipedia.
Yeah, yeah.
Great. Yeah, and I can see this like a snowball effect.
Absolutely. And then the third part is the learning experiences, and that is specific that universities, open universities, are using the material to make a kind of MOOCs, massive open source colleges, but in a different way. So they repackage it. Mm-hmm. That is something that will be done as of January, so that's not done now. Mm-hmm. Repackages to make sure that students, people that are in an other way interested, can use it to educate themselves. So they will put additional information to it. They will they will make it an educational tool to meet more people. And that is something that UNESCO found very interesting. UNESCO worldwide, so UNESCO in Paris.
Yeah, popular in China. UNESCO is like backing this up, right? Totally supportive.
Yeah, and what they did, they said, okay, we like this project so much that we give it a patronage. That means that
patronage.
So we can use UNESCO logo, and UNESCO will help us to disseminate, to spread the material worldwide, also in places where there are, where it's difficult, where you have to push a little bit to the global south, and we hope to reach a big Chinese audience.
We want the Chinese audience and also the Chinese like scientists, researchers, teachers, or people who are interested really get the benefits
and also
hope to get involved as well.
Yeah, that would be great, really, and that also maybe to continue working on the platform. So portraying more Chinese scientists and
to make the infosphere grow bigger and bigger.
That's right. That's
excellent. Before we wrap this up, do you have any expectations you want to say to our Chinese audience?
Yeah, sure. I think that's the most important, that as many people as possible are able to get access to this information, to this material, to this footage, and do with the footage what they want to do to make sure that to reach another large audience. So
we invite you to get involved, and this will definitely help you get better prepared for the future.
Yeah, and it's an honor to be here. I'd really like to be here and to be able to share this information with you. And I hope the Chinese people will also make Mind of the Universes part of ours.
Definitely. Mind of Universe cannot be without China.
That's right. Completely agree with that.
Yes. And on behalf of the Chinese audience here, thank you so much. Wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What if we create everything we can imagine? What if we can design and print any material? What if we connect our brains?
This symphony, these neuronal symphonies that we saw in rats and monkeys were there in humans. It was the same thing. And the same mathematical approach that we use to link the brain with a device would work in humans. That is when we realized that we had something gigantic. And it could advance neuroscience to realms that we never thought about before. Our biggest discovery with brain-machine interface, I think in a decade, is that if you're a paralyzed person, you may start getting recovery of motor and tactile behaviors below the level of the lesion.
Human knowledge is growing at an exponential rate.
When we all share this knowledge, we could create a whole new future.
And create a common knowledge base, a worldwide infosphere.
What if we can stop aging? What if we can program organisms and societies?
My main quest is to understand the principles that underlie intelligence, and I believe that this happens through learning, that intelligent behavior arises in nature and in the computers that we're building through learning. The machine, the animal, the human becomes intelligent because it learns.
We have a tendency to put emotions as something magical that isn't accessible to science. I don't think so. I think emotions are like anything else. They can be understood, and we can have programs or equations that follow the moves that correspond to the underlying mechanisms. We are understanding more and more about them, and we will even more in the future. And once we do that, it's good for us. You know, we can be less stupid with our emotions, as I think we are right now.
What if our networks and search engines become autonomous? What if all knowledge is accessible to everyone at all times?
A lot of the problems that you find in Africa, they are actually manageable. We can tackle them. recently, scientists at CPA in my organization, they discovered that certain mosquitoes that transmit malaria, they harbor bacteria in their body. They are unable to transmit the malaria parasite. That is a major, major discovery. And if we are able to transmit this bacteria to a wider range of the mosquito population, it is possible to significantly reduce the malaria transmission.
Who are we? Where do we come from?
Where do we go to?
These are some of the deep questions that scientists ask. Let's all share their thoughts.
What if all this happens at once? What would that mean for the world of tomorrow? And for us?
The mind of the universe is a journey along the frontiers of knowledge, giving new thoughts about science to everyone and by everyone.
Let's all join and be prepared for tomorrow.